Welcome to Scenario D,
the podcast that takes you behind the magic by giving you the facts and a whole lot of feels.
I'm Kirbs.
And I'm Lish.
And this week, we're talking about one of my all-time favorite Disney films, The Great Mouse Detective. What's not to love about a Sherlock-inspired story and one of the most horrifying Disney villains out there?
I can list a few things, starting with the fact that the villain is a literal rat.
He's not just a rat, Lish. He's also the world's greatest criminal mind, and you'd best not forget it.
Okay, Kirbs, we've got The Great Mouse Detective today, and this one, I think I've always known that you really liked this movie, and I think that, I just want to know how much of it is this movie, and how much of it are you just, like, obsessed with Sherlock Holmes?
Such a great question. I'm so glad you raised that today.
Yeah.
I actually don't think I'm obsessed with Sherlock Holmes as an entity.
No?
At all. No.
Okay.
I mean, I know you'll immediately think back to when we lived together and I was obsessed with Sherlock, the
yes.
Benedict Cumberbatch, Martin Freeman show. I actually think that with that particular show, I found the story very intriguing. I loved the production. I liked this format of long form TV content. This was kind of at the beginning of when
it was new.
Netflix was accessible,
like,
to everybody.
Peak TV was.
Yeah. It was just, the production was so high and it was nice to feel like I wasn't watching a movie, even though you kind of were. Like a season was three films, essentially. Yeah. And the quality of that storytelling and the acting and everything else was just so high that I was intrigued. This was also peak Tumblr days for me.
Ooh, yes.
And everybody on Tumblr was obsessed with Doctor Who, which I never got into, and Sherlock, which I did get into.
Yes. Yes.
So have I seen the last episode of Sherlock? No. Never finished
what?
It, actually. I know. I never finished
what?
It. It's really embarrassing.
Even I've seen the last episode of
Sherlock. I know. My dad and I were watching it together, and then we either stopped living together or ran out of steam. Honestly, it's one of those options.
You guys,
so I never actually saw it.
Need to go get some Taco Bell and have a little father-daughter Sherlock finishing.
That would be
date,
so cute. And now that he's retired, we could and should do that.
We
actually, that would be
that.
So adorable.
Yes.
We can rewatch all of it because it's been years since I watched it. And then Taco Bell and the series finale.
Okay.
That would be fantastic.
But you better, like, if you start over and then you lose steam and you don't finish.
We won't.
Okay.
I'm fairly confident that if I was to restart the clock on Sherlock, I would be 100% in again. The same way that me having watched Into the Spider-Verse and Across the Spider-Verse has reignited my Spider-Man obsession.
Right. Okay.
It's always there. It's just sleeping
now.
Sherlock
okay.
is sleeping.
So you love Sherlock, the show.
Yeah.
You love The Great Mouse Detective. But that's it. That's the extent.
That's kind
of
it.
Sherlock
I read... I read The Hounds of Baskerville, which is like the kind of Sherlock Holmes book, and I enjoyed it, but I haven't grown up captivated by Sherlock Holmes. I wasn't going out there looking for one of those ear flap hats. I wasn't out here, you know, asking for magnifying glasses. Like that's, and even detective style mysteries, not it for me.
What's
I truly.
It's like I'm more into those. I think
yes.
than you are. Like I love
yes.
murder mystery, but like Sherlock
yeah.
specifically has never been my jam.
Yeah, I think that Great Mouse Detective held an appeal because my Aunt Karen owned the VHS and my Aunt Karen was cool. I still
yeah.
think she is. So it was like one that we got to borrow, so it was kind of exciting. And also
okay.
I just because I have a weird thing with animated male animals, I don't know. I thought Basil was hot.
Basil?
I really, as a young child, was like really drawn. I think it's because he was really smart. He was really witty. He was like really in control. And I found those qualities attractive. And then it's like, okay, I guess, sure. Let's just say
Who
that we're into
hotter,
Basil.
Basil or Robin Hood?
That is an almost unfair question. I actually... Okay, wait, let me think for like 2 seconds. I thought you were going to say Basil or Clopin, and I was going to say Basil. But like, you said Robin Hood.
I
kind of... Okay, so let me just think out loud for like
okay,
one hot
go
second
for
here.
It. Yes, please.
Basil would play hard to get. Like, he's so focused on his own thing that I think that the chase would be appealing to me about that, because I'm used to having unrequited feelings that go nowhere but are so big, and then I like listen to, you know, sad songs about it, and Basil would be that one.
Yeah.
And Robin Hood is a much more like, I don't know, open and warm mm-hmm. and inviting, kind of friendly character. I feel like overall Robin Hood would be better for me.
I agree. Yes.
100%. So
yeah.
I think I would go with Robin Hood overall for that reason. But there is a piece of me that would always be wondering, like, what if with Basil? Yeah. Like, is he the one that got away? You know, if they were both actually figures in my life.
Yeah.
That's probably how it would go.
Yeah.
Wow, what a hard question to start this off with. I was really unprepared.
I'm sorry.
For that.
I'm sorry.
It's okay.
Just jump right in there. So there's a lot of like drama Disney mm-hmm. time. Should I just jump into it?
You've already thrown me off, so I need to kind of catch my breath
I'll talk about this. I mean, the 80s was such a weird time for Disney animation. So just for like a little bit of context, The Black Cauldron was released in 1985, widely regarded as the worst film in Disney animation history. I mm-hmm. actually haven't seen it, but I just feel like I know that that's true. And mm-hmm. I'm going to go back a few years before that just to fully set the stage for what was going on in the mid-80s. So we've discussed many moments throughout Disney history where the animation division almost shut down, and then a movie came along and they saved it, and there was just like a lot of close calls in the 80s where we just almost didn't make it, guys. Like, there was just a lot of things happening. So, I mean, the fact that Disney came out the other end and made it to The Great Mouse Detective is kind of a miracle. So, yeah. Anyway.
Wow.
1983, Ron Miller, who's Disney's son-in-law, we've been talking about him a lot this season, becomes CEO. In 1984, there is a hostile takeover attempt by a finance guy named Saul Steinberg.
Sorry, what?
Yes. Saul Steinberg. Some kind of, like, his job is just to, like, screw with companies and try to, like, take them over. Like, I was, like, researching this guy for, like, hours today, and I was like, what is wrong with you? And basically, he spent months buying Disney stock so that he owned a large amount of the company. It was like 12%. Mm-hmm. And in response to this, there's like a lot of back and forth with like Ron Miller and like the rest of the board. And Ron Miller's trying to buy out other companies to put under the Disney umbrella to dilute the percentage that he has. This also put Disney in a lot more debt, which they had a lot of at the time. So like overall, the company is just like not looking great. So Steinberg is essentially calling for a shareholders' vote to oust the board in favor of a new board that he selected, which would essentially give him complete control of the company. And based on how the Disney company is set up, he would need an 80% shareholders' vote in order to win and make that happen. So obviously, this is making the board of directors, which Ron Miller is a part of, Roy Disney is a part of, a bunch of other old white men are a part of, and they're all just, like, crapping their pants because if this were to happen, they'd all, like, lose everything. And in addition to that, this guy's made it clear that he just wants to sell the company for parts, so the Disney company would cease to exist as we know it if he were to pull this off. So this has a lot of emotional weight for people like Roy and Ron, who mm-hmm. are actually, like, connected to Walt via their family, his son-in-law and nephew. And, I mean, a lot of the people on the board have been on the board for a long time, and it's just, like, this holds a lot of financial weight and emotional weight for all of these guys. So it's really, really stressful. A lot of, like, back and forth discussion, and essentially the board was left with no choice but to offer him a crazy amount of money for his 12% of shares to, like, make him go away. And most likely this was his plan the entire time, was to just get this massive guy out from the board.
Well, that's what I was gonna say. Like, what is the, you know, assumption of why he was trying to do this?
And I mean, if he was able to pull off the takeover, he would have made a crazy amount of money from like selling off the company and all that stuff too.
Right.
But this, like, he made like $50+ million doing this, like buying the shares
just casually,
and getting the money for so
Wow.
It was a stressful time, and tensions were super high, especially between Roy, who's Walt's nephew, and Ron, his son-in-law.
Right.
They disagreed throughout this process how to handle the takeover and the, like, management of the company as a whole. So there was just a lot of, like, you know, disagreements, tensions, and, like, the company, it's not doing too well. Like, Disney's not really, like, thriving at this point. So we've talked about Roy and his, like, Save Disney campaign before. So he actually had two. This happened twice. Roy resigned from the board twice. So this is the first time that he resigned from the board. And the second was, I can't remember what episode we talked about it in, but it was basically when he wrote that letter, basically talking about all the things that Michael Eisner's done wrong, and like,
yes.
That happened later in the 2000s. This is in the 80s. This is his first
resignation.
And the fallout of this was essentially Ron Miller being ousted and bringing in Michael Eisner, Frank Wells, and Jeffrey Katzenberg. They have now, in 1984, all entered the Disney chat. So they ended up bringing Roy back to oversee the animation division, so that's how he got back into things. And since none of them came from animation, they were essentially shocked when they're so what's happening right now is both the Black Cauldron and the Great Mouse Detective are in production at Disney Animation Studios, and they're looking at how they're just like, what it costs, how much money to make these, it takes how long, like what, and they're just completely shocked at the amount of like investment that goes into these.
But like, in their defense, that's us with anything we've done with this podcast. Like, we also are like, oh, yeah, I can like get my stuff together in 20 minutes in between meetings. That's fine. And then 3 hours later, I'm watching Selling Sunset and madly typing about the Great Mouse Detective in order to be prepared for this.
Yeah.
And we've done this how many times
I know.
I'm still surprised. Right?
I mean,
so I get it.
That's fair, but it's like with something, if they had had any experience in animation, they would have looked at a schedule or a budget or something like that before. But since these guys are coming in completely green, they're just like, oh, I thought like, you know, it'd be like a year and like a couple of guys and we'd have like an animated feature. And it's like, no, Michael Eisner, this, like, we are drawing frame by frame here. That's.
But, like, I don't know why I'm all of a sudden filled with empathy, compassion, and grace for Jelly Ketchup and friggin' Mikey Eisner over there. But, like, when you entered animation as a field, did you know everything about the production process that you now know?
No, of course not.
I think the bigger problem, then, is that they're bringing in green people to an industry that, like, needs, and particularly a company that is looking for people who can lead it. So, if you're coming in here and telling me I know nothing about it, but I have a wish and a prayer and I'm going to figure it out, like, that's not quite necessarily, I mean, it worked out. Spoiler, worked out.
It
but, like,
out.
That's not necessarily what we need.
I think they were smart in keeping Roy in the mix because he did have a little bit more of the animation experience. But I also feel like they really didn't have a ton of strong, like, producers and leadership at the Disney Animation Studio at this time. Like, this is still through all that transition where nine old men have left. Like, the only one kind of lingering a little bit right now is Eric Larson. So it's just like that, you know, there's still that gap there that we've been talking about since, like, Walt died, essentially. Then, like, Willie Reitherman's now out of the picture. Like, we're... The Black Cauldron is just like a byproduct of nobody knows how to do this anymore.
The Black Cauldron is a black hole. Just, you know,
they had like
a quagmire.
Six different directors trying to put something together and they weren't even talking to each other. Like, it was just like the hot mess, hot messes. That we'll do that podcast another day. But in terms of this one, yeah, you're totally right. Like, was bringing in a bunch of people that didn't really know anything about animation helpful to the situation? No, but I mean, at least they brought in some fresh energy, and
yes,
I will credit them that they didn't shut things down, because like that was also on the table and something that people really thought was going to happen. Mm-hmm. While the Great Mouse Detective and the Black Cauldron were in production, they like essentially moved the team. This is when they moved them out to like the portables that got kicked out of the
right.
like, beautiful animation studio. And like everybody just kind of thought like, okay, this is it. Like so much so that like they were interviewing at other studios and mm-hmm. like, you know, the animators themselves thought like, okay, they're going to kill this. But because Roy was still around, he really fought to keep the animation studio going. And
right.
Michael Eisner has said it was never really on the table because of Roy, like to get rid of the animation studio. They just had to keep it. And the three of them had to kind of learn and figure it out as best as they could. So gotcha. The Black Cauldron comes out and just an astronomical flop, lost so mm-hmm. much money. The leadership team from that film was fired by Jelly Ketchup, who, in case you're new around here, is Jeffrey Katzenberg. And that brings us to The Great Mouse Detective. So this was originally pitched to Ron Miller in 1982, and The Black Cauldron was already a crapshoot by this point, and like even the animators were like, can we please work on something yeah. else? So they had to like greenlight something else just so people could have a break from working on The Black Cauldron.
Yeah.
And about a year and a half into production is when this executive mix-up happened. So they had to repitch everything to the new team of Michael Eisner, Frank Wells, and Jeffrey Katzenberg. And so, yeah, they had to, like, re-go through everything and have them approve it. Eisner did approve the project, but he slashed the proposed budget in half after seeing the full storyboards and then moved up their release date 18 months. Ooh. At this point, left them like a year and no money to finish.
Yeah, I was about to say, no money, no time is less yes. money, more problems. Like, this just, it's not, the math ain't mathing.
The math ain't mathing. The original directors were Bernie Mattinson and John Musker, which, mm-hmm. you know, starting to hear some familiar names. Dave Michener was added as sort of a director-producer after Ron Miller was ousted. And with this new revised schedule and everything that they had to adhere to, they ended up having to add Ron Clements as a director as well to get the film done, which this would have started the relationship of Ron and John, which we love.
We love them.
Yeah. So along with Ron and John, who went on to direct some of the best films of the Renaissance and Revival at Disney, we're really starting to see some of our favorite Renaissance animators crop up on this film. So we've got Mark Henn, who's doing Basil, Andreas Dejah, who's doing the Queen, and then Glenn Keane, who he's doing Ratigan, and I'm just gonna like hand this Ratigan discussion like right over to you, because You're kind of like obsessed with him, right? Like Ratigan.
Ratigan. Like, I think that Ratigan is one of the best villains Disney has ever made. I think that he is one of the like truly most evil villains out there. Like, he's freaky deaky. First of all, that transition, that transformation mm-hmm. from like a mouse into a rat inside the clock tower is crazy. Mm-hmm. He loves talking about killing orphans and widows and grandmas and babies and like all this. He like throws his own henchmen to his cat Felicia. He's just like so diabolical in everything that he does. And I think a big part of that is because they had Vincent Price mm-hmm. voice yeah. him. And he's the guy who did the Thriller monologue at mm-hmm. the end of that epic song and music video. It's just perfect. He was thrilled to be, you know, the voice actor for the world's most, what is it? The world's greatest criminal mind mm-hmm. is one of Ratigan's songs. And I mean, there's just a lot of really interesting dichotomies at play with Ratigan too, because he's like super fancy and likes really fine things. But then he's also just so grotesquely violent. Mm-hmm. He loves planning parties, but he also loves planning murders. Like he's kind of two sides of the coin.
I never thought of Ratigan as someone who loves planning parties.
Are you kidding me? He planned his own kind of like, oh my goodness, I'm a star, I'm a genius type of party with his henchmen, with the big fountain and everything. Yeah. He plans this crazy over-the-top murder scheme, this like, what do they call that? Oh, Rube Goldberg machine, where like, you know, this thing goes down here and then it's going to put the mouse trapped like to kill Basil with a photo finish.
That's true. He is a planner. I can respect
that. He wrote his own song just to go along with that murder of Basil. The goodbye so soon.
Might be a Virgo. We'll have to see.
I am obsessed with him. And what I think is even more interesting, just to add one more layer to like Radigan as a character in the film, is that like in the book, the original story that they based this adaptation on, he was a mouse pretending to be a rat to claim like more power and more kind of prestige or more clout. But in the film, he's a rat pretending to be a mouse, which I think is an interesting switch. I never really discovered through my, you know, feverish Selling Sunset inspired research why they made that change. To me, I see it as him having this ultimate trump card. Like, yes, I am one of you. I ingratiate myself to you. I can, you know, have conversations with you and lead you really well. But in the event that he needs to, like, turn it on, he's like, I'm a rat, dudes. Like, I can take all of you in a fight. And we see that, of course, come out in that epic fight between him and Basil in the clock tower. So he's like this perverse balance of all these different things all coming together, which makes him a really nice foil for Basil, because Basil is kind of more, he's not a two-dimensional character. I think there's a lot of stuff going on with him, but he keeps it all very close to the chest. He's very aloof. He's very like, I don't know. He doesn't like children. He's understated. And he's also just so intellectual. We're in his head for so much of the movie. And that's one of the things that makes him such an interesting hero here too, because he's not relying on magic or tricks in order to get anything done. Like, he actually has skills. So we see forensic sciences, ballistics, chemistry, like all this stuff kind of coming into play, which you don't get otherwise.
So, I mean, I've never actually read Sherlock Holmes, but like I've seen like various things. It feels like he's very true to that character. Like, it's, that is very, like, recognizable to me.
Yes.
Especially watching it now. I didn't get it when I was a kid, but watching it now, it really
100%
felt real.
100%. A lot of Sherlock Holmes, like, super fans see The Great Mouse Detective as one of the best interpretations of that original group of stories, because they're using all the classic Holmes tropes in a way that seems to make sense. So Basil and Dawson are modeled up obviously after Sherlock and Watson, and they're pretty similar. There's a lot of, you know, those traditional stereotypes of Watson playing second fiddle to Basil, you know, kind of chasing behind him, but ultimately being able to help him solve a problem. Like, in a pinch, it's not Holmes on his own. He needs Watson to get it done. And they even alluded to this guy, Basil Rathbone, who's most famously known as Sherlock Holmes in films. He actually makes a vocal cameo in the film. He died before the film came out, but you hear Sherlock, the human version, speak for like 1 second, and it's like a line from a film he was in. It's like one of his lines of dialogue, which is cool. And there's also just like a really interesting play with the characters and story in this one too, that like we see a lot of mice in Disney films, but they've never, with the exception of Mickey, been the hero or really the star. They've always played kind of like a small supporting role. Like in Cinderella, the mice are, you know, characters with agency, but they're never actually in charge. They're always subject to human worlds. And this film, Basil, Radigan, Watson, not Watson, Dawson, my apologies, Dawson, they're all living in their own world. Like, humans are secondary. You only see Sherlock's shadow for like 1 second. That's the only mention of humans. They have their own government. They have their own society. Like, they have a nightlife. They have kind of all this stuff that makes them their independent world, which is kind of like, it's so different than what we've seen with animals. Animals acting as animals.
It is different, but I do find it interesting that this being so, I guess it's not like soon after the Rescuers, because that was quite a few years before, but still.
It's a decade later.
In the grand scheme of like what, not too much came out in between. So it's just like to just keep going with the mice. I guess the Rescuers would have been their like last successful film. So maybe they're leaning into that.
And I think they've, like, Cinderella, people love Gus and Jacques. Love them. Obsessed. For sure. Big fans. Mickey is a mouse. Like, there are a lot of mice that people have gravitated towards, both in and out of Disney. And I think mice are safe You know, like they're easy to make cute. They're not imposing. They can have their own world underneath a human world without taking up too much space or needing to interact with humans. And I think they were trying to make this a truly, you know, animal-centric film, but it happens in real time, so it feels a little bit more relatable and makes a concept like Sherlock Holmes, which is probably a bit more mature for children's audiences, it makes it a bit more digestible and more fun for them to animate, too. Like, that play between whether they're walking on two legs or four. Again, we come back to this clock scene over and over and over again, just because I know there was so much cool tech stuff in it as well. But, like, that scene where you see Radigan transform from a humanistic rat into, like, a full-out, just full-blown feral rat is a really, really, like, visually stunning scene, but also a really stark contrast between the difference between Basil as the hero and Radigan as this, you know, disgusting villain as well. Yeah. So, yeah,
totally.
I mean, best Disney scene ever? I would say it's up there. It's up there.
No.
Yes, it is. It's up there.
I mean, it was by far the best scene of the movie, and it is an impressive scene, but there's a lot of impressive Disney scenes, Kirbs.
We're clearly not going to come to an agreement on the best Disney scenes, and I want to be clear, once again, with The Lion King, I feel like I know you're going to say, like, oh, something from The Lion King, and guess what? I didn't say that this scene is the best. I just said it's up there because of how it uses character development, technology, perspective, storytelling, pacing. Like, it kind of does everything really well. And I think a lot of that is because of the technology they were using. It was the first we'd seen of this type of
thing. It was, like, an absolute standout. And the original finale, what they were going to do, it was just going to take place on the hands of Big Ben. Like, there was going to be none of this inside in the gears kind of thing. And layout artist Mike Pereza actually pitched the idea of the gears and the whole, like, breaking through the tower part. His inspiration for the scene came from the Japanese anime film The Castle of Cagliostro. And his team, Pereza and his team, actually went to London. They were granted, like, special access inside the clockworks of Big Ben to actually see how everything looked and how the gears worked.
And you really, they don't let people in there.
No, like, no. Like, that's, like, a huge deal. You can't just, like, go and check that out clock, on, please. Like, a Tuesday. Like, that was, like, a special, like, Disney thing.
Yeah.
And so after kind of, like, looking at all their options, they kind of realized that CGI was really their only way to appropriately pull this off. So CGI had really not been used. It was used a little bit in The Black Cauldron, but nothing to this extent. That was more just like certain effects and certain, like, assets kind of thing. But to have, like, an entire set be CGI, that had really never happened in a Disney movie before. So they produced the gears in CGI, and then what they ended up doing is tracing that onto animation cells so that the 2D color and characters could be added. Because, like, that's another, you know, tougher aspect of having, like, the hybrid. Like, obviously, if you're building a set in CG, you're going to need to put the characters in, and they don't have CG characters. Like, we're not there yet in the 80s. So it's like they're still 2D. So they had to figure out how to integrate the two. And that was really the first time that that had been done successfully. So, so that's, like, the only way that the camera movements and the rotations and just, like, that, like, amazing shot from, like, behind Basil and, like, so much of this. Like, it is really, really good, and it actually holds up really well.
So then why are you out here trying to tell me this is not, like, one of the best Disney scenes?
Like, I just don't, like, think. Like, what do you think? Are you saying, like, top 5, top 10? Like, where are you going to put it?
I'm willing to colloquially say top 10. For me personally, this is a top 5. But that's me coming at it with the emotional connection to this film. I think objectively, if we look at what they accomplished, how good it looks, and the fact that it holds up, it has to be in the top 10 because they did a lot of other experimenting with stuff that does not hold up. Right?
That's true.
It has a lot of drama.
I will say, in terms of the technology, this was groundbreaking in the sense that this happened a lot in the Renaissance. And this was really the first time that they did this. Like, we saw this in with the ship in The Little Mermaid. We saw this with the ballroom and Beauty and the Beast, the Stampede in The Lion King. So yeah. It's like, I will say, we'll give the credit to this film for being, you know, the kind of like stepping stone that opened up the possibilities for those CG sets or assets that were used in a lot of those very important scenes. So I will give you that. Maybe top 10. Maybe squeaking in there.
I think you're thinking too much with your heart, not enough with your head here when it comes to a top 10 list, because I would love to know what you would put in there. And I'm willing to bet you it's just scenes that made you feel something. And
I know.
That's fine.
I know.
But this is the difference between, like, what is a Virgo? An earth sign? An earth sign and a fire sign. You're coming in here all feelings and whatever. And I'm like, no, facts are facts, sister. Listen, this if we're going to break this down, it's not at the top of a top 10 list.
Look, but if it's important technological scenes, then yes, absolutely, it's in there. But it's like, best just means so many different things. And
But I listed so many things it does well. The sound design is great on this scene as well. That, like, really echoing tick-tock of the clock is amazing. The way that they fade from black as he, like, gains consciousness. He's looking around. That, like, turntable shot.
Yeah.
Radigan's transformation, the work of contrast with the shadows, and then them actually getting into a physical altercation. Like, they really, that transition from the CGI to the 2D is crazy.
It's really good.
I don't want to hear anything else about it. Like, unless you are singing its praises and giving it a medal.
You know what bothers me about it?
Oh, my goodness.
It's so stupid, but I am bothered by all of the brown. You know how I hate so much brown in animated movies? And that is the main reason that I just don't really like this movie in general, is because there's just so much brown. And
Radigan has a purple ascot on.
So much brown.
He's got like a pink
way too much
something.
Brown.
I can't. Sometimes the things that bother you are just
they
stupid.
Don't make any
quite
sense.
Honest.
I want you to know that I know that.
Yeah, like, I respect you as a woman in animation. I was going to say a woman in STEM. Sorry, girl. That's not you. I respect you as a professional in this industry. And I, as a fool on the sidelines, know that I don't always know what's going on. But I do know that this opinion of yours is a silly one.
I know. Silly.
Because you're ignoring all the facts for a feel. And that's a shenanigan. That is a true shenanigan.
You're right. You're
over
right.
here.
Yeah.
Take you to church on that one, let me tell you. I do think that this scene is also fascinating because there is, I don't know if you've ever seen the conversations online of people saying that this film was actually the start of the Renaissance because of how technologically advanced it was. And yet, you can't really say that because Oliver and Company was a real low point.
And like, there's, like, the second Rescuers. That's just...
Yes. Like, there's too much in between.
It's not
The Little Mermaid.
Yeah.
Yeah. And even though it's only a period of, like, 2 years, those 2 years are big for, to your earlier points about how, like, the success of animation at Disney is still really riding waves with each film. You can't really claim it that, but it is, you know, the light on the horizon. This is Gandalf telling Aragorn to look to the mountain or whatever on the second day at sunrise.
Yeah.
Aragorn is looking and he knows
it's like
Gandalf
the fifth
is coming.
Day, but yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
First
yeah,
light on the fifth day. At dawn.
I
want to
say second.
To the east.
Can we make it second? Yeah, look to the east and then he shows up. Carl Urban is there.
Oh,
you're
yeah.
excited. I'm excited. Everybody's excited.
It's great.
You know
it's
who wasn't excited? You know who wasn't excited, though? The audience to receive this film. This is a classic Kirbs segue.
Really?
Yeah.
I thought this one did well. Like, I thought that Black Cauldron, like, lost a bunch of money, and this one made money. Is that
this
wrong?
One kept them afloat, but that's not the same as doing well. Like,
fair.
That's, it's not, you know, mass commercial success. Like, for starters, people are really loving to do some rewriting of history here. Like, from within the Disney company, even. Like, you know, these budget cuts that Mikey was like, listen, we're going to cut the budget at the knees and we're going to push it out the door before it's ready. You know, that's basically what we're going to do. There's a lot of in-house Disney historians around that time and public relations kind of people that were like, oh my goodness, Michael Eisner was so courageous for making this decision. Like, he really believed in the animators and, you know, he was inspiring Disney animators to create new cost-effective methods of using tech and blah, blah, blah to slash animation costs. So, like, they really tried to cover their own butt here and, like, not make this sound like we didn't know what we were doing. So, from the jump, Disney's like, this might not be it. Yeah. This might not be it, but, like, it has to go out.
Right.
And then, you know, like, we can't ignore either. I'm surprised you didn't call this out because this is a thing I really thought you would have mentioned. In the background of half of these scenes, the characters don't move at all. It's actually just a still image. Especially you can see it in the pub. Like,
It's
really, really obnoxious and awful. And this scene then got a lot of attention because people are like, that background's really horrible. And also, this is the first clear instance of, like, sex in a Disney movie. That mouse burlesque dancer coming out going, hey fellas, like, what are we doing? Like, this cabaret singing mouse's legs are on full display. The Motion Picture Association of America, Association of America, the MPAA, as it were, found the entire thing, like, way too risque. So, like, even before this can go in front of audiences, people are going, this is a mistake. Like, I don't, or a mouse steak. I don't know what we're doing here. We're doing something that's, like, not safe
for
children's entertainment.
Did they want to give it a PG rating?
They sure did. They were like, we should put a PG rating on this entire film. Like, that scene alone, this animated mouse's leg is too much. So, and the song is called Let Me Be Good to You, and the lyrics are like, hey fellas, I'll take off all my blues, she's wearing blue, hey fellas, there's nothing I won't do just for you. It's pretty suggestive. Like, I know we gave Duchess a hard time with the if you want to turn me on. This is worse. This is by far worse.
It's just like, was this essential to the plot at all? Like, why?
No. I think it came from the composer on the film really kind of wanting to have fun with the scene. Mm-hmm. And this scene was actually a solve to a poor suggestion that Michael Eisner had made. Like, originally, this was going to be a song called Are You the One Who Loves Me, which was going to be a parody of some of the, like, Victorian British music hall style, kind of like rough and tumble pub music. And Jeffrey Katzenberg and the rest of the management team was like, no, we don't want to do that. That's, like, too suggestive of being in a bar. They wanted a more contemporary song that could make it more marketable because Jelly Ketchup is going, like, I don't know what I'm doing. Let's, like, make it marketable. So Michael Eisner said, why not Michael Jackson? Why not Michael Jackson? So many reasons why not Michael Jackson. And, like, we're forgetting any of his legal stuff.
Yeah, because that would have come after this.
That was after. Yeah. We're just literally thinking about how inappropriate it would be for Michael Jackson, the mouse.
Yeah.
Eisner suggested that Jackson be a character that enters the bar and confronts Basil before singing this song. Obviously, the animators were like, no.
Like, I mean, how much would you have loved to see Michael Jackson, though?
Mysel Jackson,
Mysel
I would have
Jackson.
Been very, yeah, like Mice Jackson. Yeah, I would be very into that. But the animators, apparently, rumor goes, legend has it, that they didn't even respond to this suggestion. Like, they're like, we're going to keep going with what we have. Like, we're going to figure something else out. And then Michael Eisner was like, okay, maybe not Michael, but what about Madonna? Or what about Liza Minnelli?
Is that supposed to be like Madonna? That's...
No. It just, those suggestions were shot down because they're awful. And so
I kind of love how at this point the animators have just, like, had it, that they're just, like, blatantly, like, the CEO gives them a suggestion and they're like, no, we're not doing that.
You're cutting our budget in half. Yeah. You're telling me I won't see my kids for, like, 3 months because I have to get this done in, you know, 15 months instead of a year and a half.
For you.
None of that. We are not deigning that with a response. So, you know, they eventually ended up with this mouse with legs, which was, like, way too sexy. Mm-hmm. And even though the Black Cauldron was a PG rating and Disney was fine with that, they were like, oh, we can't have a PG rating on this movie, though. Like, we absolutely cannot. For a can-can dance performed by mice, we can't possibly get a PG rating for that. So, you know, the pub scene, we got poor animation in the background. We got a weirdly sexual mouse on the stage. We got a lot of weird stuff going on. And there was another scene that the MPAA also wasn't happy with, which was that scene, Radigan's party. Again, he's throwing a party. He's playing the harp. He's feeling himself. And then there's that super drunk mouse, right? Like, oh, Radigan, that guy. So he's clearly, this kind of harkens back to with the rescuers, where I was like, Luke is clearly drunk at all times and using alcohol as a way to cope. This mouse was even more obviously under the influence because we see him like drinking from this fountain the whole time. He's like avoiding everybody else and just like focusing on getting more alcohol into his system. So after some discussion, an agreement that a scene that ends with the death of a rather drunk mouse could hardly be said to have a pro-alcohol spin on it. The MPAA was like, that's fine. We can leave it in this G-rated movie. And that could have saved Disney a lot of money because if they had had to change it, that's more money that they have to spend to animate the scene. That's more time that they have to spend, you know, fixing it. So there were parts of Scandinavia that still made this a PG or like 12 plus film for some of these reasons. But I mean, that's Scandinavia. They did their own thing. In the States and Canada, it was like, everybody's welcome, come to see this movie.
I kind of get it. I'm trying to remember, because we definitely had this movie. I was talking to one of my sisters, and she's 5 years younger than me. She said she's never seen it, which means that, like, I must have watched it, like, super
like one time and
really,
then,
really young. Because I remember watching it a bunch, but I must have been, like, younger than 5, so.
Well, and I think the thing that should have gotten it a PG rating is just how intense that fight between Radigan and Basil
is. Like, Radigan is scary.
He is legitimately terrifying. And I mean, I love that because I just love Radigan so much. I just think he's so good in every single way. He's a type of, and like, there's kidnapping. We're kidnapping a small child. Do you know what I mean? Like, we've got.
Yes. They were trying to like pull a Penny a little bit in the beginning with like the small child just looking
but
for Basil.
Isn't it interesting though that Penny being kidnapped did not scare me at all when I was a young child? Like, first of all, fidget creepy. Like that bat
so
with
creepy.
The peg leg, that was a lot for me.
Yeah.
It actually, like, I knew that I was going to be fine because the bat was kidnapping a mouse and not a human girl. So I was like, okay, I'm safe. Like, that was honestly what made me feel safe. But the kidnapping scene is quite violent as
it
well.
Is.
Like,
we
see the shadows, you hear all this scuffling, like, you know, it's the emotions around it are a lot. And even though it's an adult being kidnapped, the fact that Olivia is left behind alone is like so much more intense.
Yeah.
It's so much more visceral. And when I was a kid, that was very much kind of like, no, this doesn't work for me. But I mean, I still overall enjoyed the movie, but those kind of two scenes, one right at the beginning and one right at the end, were really intense.
Quite,
so
quite scary. Yeah.
Yeah. Sure. And the MPAA is like, you're good. Put it on through.
I know.
We're like,
things,
okay,
things
well.
Like that. Like, your little kids everywhere are crapping their pants with this. Man.
Yeah.
You don't even know.
Yeah. Like,
they don't care about like the suggestive leg of the mouse, and they don't care about the drunk. They have not even clocked that the character is drunk, but
they just think he's silly.
They're just they're going to be scared of the terrifying villain.
But you know what? No one said the MPAA had their priorities straight. No. They also let Hellfire go through how much later? Do you know what I mean? Like, we have with nary a thought. They basically were like, that sniff is a little loud, but otherwise, looks great.
Amazing.
Full out sexual predator in a church, but you know what? Good to go. Feels right. Like,
thumbs
it's
up.
Crazy.
No.
It's crazy. So, you know, Disney's trying to rewrite history with their public relations team. We have the MPAA being like, this isn't quite it. This might be a little bit too suggestive and a little bit too pro-alcohol for us. Oh, wait, never mind. It's fine. So this movie goes out the door. Critics really liked it. Like, critics thought this movie was great. They're like, this is a return to form. This is really impactful. The animation is fantastic. Look at this technology. But there was a tiny little problem. In its name was An American Tale, and it came out at the same time as this movie. So we've got two big animation studios with movies about mice rocking at the same time. And for those who do not recall or remember, we've mentioned before, but Don Bluth had left Disney to start his own studio, and An American Tale is by far one of his most popular animated films. And while Some people don't think it's that great, myself included. It did beat The Great Mouse Detective at the box office. It really overshadowed Great Mouse Detective because Don Bluth released this film with Steven Spielberg's name attached. So now we have extra kind of production clout behind it. We have really recognizable names. So, you know, both the studios, since that this kind of, you know, release fiasco, have claimed that it was, you know, a sheer coincidence that they didn't plan it this way. I'm not willing to take Don at his word quite. Disney is just trying to keep its head above water, so honestly, I'm willing to believe them.
Do you think there's, like, a way that he would have known? Or, I don't know, like, I would have to look into, like, what was kind of, like, in production first and what came from where. It is definitely highly sus.
It's sus.
But this, this has happened, like, a few times. Like, wasn't it the same with, like, Road to El Dorado and, like, Emperor's New Groove and, like, all that kind of stuff. Like, it's definitely...
It's suspicious. Yeah. I mean, I think you've said it yourself. Here in Canada, the animation industry is small. It's very, very small. You kind of have to keep every door and bridge clear just in case you might need to walk over it or through it. And I'm sure the same as can be said with huge studios in the States, especially around this time it's not that big.
Yeah,
absolutely. So, you know... The fact that down the road, Jeffrey Katzenberg starts his own animation studio, he's going to have people that are still friends with him or connected to him that are working at Disney and, like, vice versa. I think there's just a lot of table talk that probably happened and still means that the studios were putting money, time, effort into making these full-fledged films. But it is curious.
Yeah.
You know, it's like... Should I be, again, should I be putting on my Sherlock hat, getting a magnifying glass, and looking into this further? I'm not going to, because ain't nobody got time for that. But it's a thing you could do. Yeah. You could decide. That's what you want to do. So, movie comes out. People are like, eh, whatever. The thing that got most people excited was the steampunk aesthetic. So, when I say steampunk, what do you think that means? Do you know what it means? Have you heard this before?
I mean, I've heard it before. I don't really have, would never classify The Great Mouse Detective as
steampunk.
I would love to know how that kind of fits together.
Yeah, this is what's so fascinating. So steampunk largely came into, like, popular culture in 1987. So very close to the time that this movie came out, shortly after. And, I mean, there's evidence of it being, you know, appearing in pop culture as far back as the 1950s. But essentially, it's a subgenre of science fiction that uses retro-futuristic technology, say that three times fast, and a bunch of, like, you know, kind of aesthetics related to that in order to celebrate industrial steam-powered machinery. So in the 50s, there was this kind of nostalgic hearkening back to, like, what was the future and celebrating what could have been if we had kept moving very much in that steam-powered direction.
Okay.
And that's why you get a lot of, like, alternative histories happening. You get a lot of these weird kind of dystopian worlds and that seem very similar to a Victorian era or the American Wild West. Like, cowboys wearing goggles and riding, like, rockets type situation. A lot of analog technology as well. So, in this movie, that comes to life through, you know, Radigan's getaway car is a hot air balloon with a bike attached. These kinds of icons are very much associated with steampunk. The whole clock scene, the fact that we're celebrating through the visuals, the gears, the way it sounds, the way it works together, like that kind of craftsmanship is very much part of that as well. The Queen robot, very much automatons and robotics were very much part of that aesthetic as well. And the fact that this takes place in a late Victorian time period also kind of just comes together. And the fact that Sherlock Holmes as stories, you know, have been popular since, like, the steam focused era all the way until now. So we're getting a lot of these cultural touch points. And as a result, this movie has gained some cult following from people who really love that genre of science fiction. And I mean, to me, the funnest expression of this in the film is Radigan's Rube Goldberg-inspired death machine for Basil. That's another kind of, like, this does this and this goes over here, but it's all based on things that don't plug in. It's all based on kind of, like, science and making it fit together. So People love to talk about it for that reason, but not enough that this movie really had staying power for, like, you know, from a merch perspective. I feel like a lot of the time that we talk about impacts of movies, I'm like, wow, they let you adopt three puppies in your name and put a star in the sky and you could get a teapot and take your mom out for dinner and whatever else. This was basically nothing. I do have a Ratigan pin and I'm very proud of it.
Okay.
It is one of the few places you can find Great Mouse Detective merch would be through pin trading. So they did have some Basil pins. They had a Ratigan pin as part of a villain collection. Very, very hard to find nowadays because pin trading is also significantly less.
No mugs. Do you have any mugs? I don't think anybody ever sees one.
I need it. It's not a want, but a need, as Troy and Gabriella would say. So ear to the ground, eyes on the horizon. Fifth day to the east or whatever it is, like, we're looking for that. And I do have a celebratory ornament. So Steve Thompson, one of our favorite designers.
Yeah.
Yes, and I do have it. It's Basil with his magnifying glass and Watson behind him. It's like a prized ornament of mine. It makes it on the tree every year because it's just so cute. But, like, all this to say, it's kind of like a want. Well, like, they go through all of this to get to this point with this movie coming out. They have all this cool technology that, you know, down the road is going to prove to be really useful. And it feels like this film just didn't really accomplish very much. Like, sure, it kept the lights on, but, like, no one was that excited about it. But I think that even with this minimal success, we can take away three main legacy pieces that came out of this movie that we start to see more in the Renaissance. The first thing is that, as you already called out so beautifully and eloquently, this is the first Disney film to extensively use computer technology to animate something. Mm-hmm. That's huge. I have for years been that, I shouldn't say I've been an idiot, but I was someone who was like, you know, that in Beauty and the Beast is the first time they use computer technology. What a maroon I am.
Were you telling people that, Kirbs?
Oh, probably. Oh, no. I can't. Okay. I don't even want to hear you say that you never once said that either as a young child. I was saying it as an adult.
I was just like, did we say that on our Beauty and the Beast episode?
No, we were very clear that it was a certain, like, software. It was like caps or whatever. Yeah. It's like, that's the first use of that.
Caps was in The Little Mermaid, but yeah.
Okay. I don't want to hear this correction right now. I'm trying to apologize for a grievous error that I've been making for years, telling people things and they trust me because I'm the most passionate Disney fan they know. And now I'm having to come out here very publicly on this platform, be vulnerable and say, yeah, I was wrong, you know?
Yeah.
Still sounds smart though. So
yeah, you know, no, whatever. It does.
So that's the first thing, right? It's like guaranteed to help Disney make better things in the future. It's going to help them cut down costs on some of the animation stuff, but allow them to invest in the areas that matter most. Mm-hmm. Two, this film convinced Jeffrey Katzenberg that his plan to release one animated film a year was not only a good one, but also financially possible. So coming back to that conversation of, you know, some people think this is the start of the Renaissance. A lot of people would argue that this is the financial start of the Renaissance because this film helped fuel and pay for what came out
in the late 80s to 90s. I kind of wish this was the start of the Renaissance because it's like, this is when all those executives started. It's like momentum is there, but like, we don't have the Howard yet. We don't, you know, we don't have that. So that really is missing, like, the final push, but, like, this is the start of the start.
Yeah, it's, you know what? We could describe Great Mouse Detective as the backer for the Disney Renaissance, you know? It came in and said, I'm willing to put money behind that. Ironically, it's kind of ties a nice bow on what you shared at the beginning about that guy trying to buy up all the stocks, right? Mm-hmm. It's like, Great Mouse Detective is coming in and saying, like, I'm putting all chips on Disney here. We're going to keep going in this direction. Please take everything that I made and keep building on top of it. So very, very nicely laying a foundation. And then thirdly, we cannot leave this conversation without once again reminding everyone how momentous it was to have Ron Clements and John Musker come together as co-directors, because they would go on to co-direct some of the most successful Renaissance films, some of our favorite films, and really just do magical things. So can you believe they're still doing it? I think it's great that people do think that this movie started the Renaissance, because then you can steal that classic phrase, it was all started by a mouse. I'm just saying.
Can put that in here too. Oh, man.
I don't want to say I wrote it because I didn't, but I did put that line someone else wrote in here. And I think that sounds right. It feels right. Okay, Lish, I feel a little humbled a little bit embarrassed, a little bit calmer than I did earlier in our conversation about this movie when I made the really aggressive statement about the fact that I thought the clock scene was the greatest Disney film of all time. And I was really ready to go to bat for that. And then I'm taking just literally a beat to think about that statement. And while it might be in my top 10, maybe even top 5, I really feel like if I, as a self-professed Disney expert of any kind, am going to make that sort of statement, I really need to make sure that that is a truth talk and not just a Kirbs' fun fact. Like, I really feel like I put it into a truth category when it's more of a feeling, you know? Like,
it was an in the moment, this is fresh feeling.
I was fired up.
I said this in the episode, but there's a lot of really, really good Disney scenes in there.
There are.
It's kind of tough to be like,
this is the best. Okay. And I was really committed to the bit. And you know what? I think that everyone should recognize the humility it takes for me to walk that back, because normally, my normal MO is to just like roll with that until I die. Like, take it to the grave.
Double down. Yeah.
Double down and say, no, it is this. And like, I'll throw everything else out. It's garbage. But I am willing to admit that this might take a bit more thought, consideration from me, and that I'm willing to put that work in. I'm pledging here and now to put that work in to actually determine for real if this is in my top
list. I can't wait to see what that list looks like.
Neither can I.
Yeah, it's gonna be good. It's gonna be good.
Yeah.
I need to apologize for being too hard on the color palette of this movie. You really shouldn't, you know, be super against something just because of all the brown. And I don't love brown. It's not my favorite color. I don't like when it's overly in movies, but it shouldn't be a reason why I like don't like this movie or appreciate the movie. So I apologize.
It is a pretty superficial reason. Yeah. Like, again, not giving much thought to what we're saying here. Yeah. We're just leading with our hearts.
Just leaning too much into my aesthetic preferences. And
Fewer facts, more feels is really we've had going on here.
Yes.
And we couldn't have reached any of these facts without, of course, some resources. We know that Paul Estelle was involved. I don't even need to call him out anymore. Yeah. That's just a given. But I did read a couple of very interesting articles to prepare for this. And honestly, I probably went overboard with the research. In total, I consulted like 10 different sources, but we're only going to mention 4.
Okay.
The first is an article called This Too Started with a Mouse, The Great Mouse Detective by Mari Ness for tor.com. Then I found an article called The Great Mouse Detective, Rise and Fall of the Mouse by SDG for Decent Films. From there, we found another article called The Great Mouse Detective Dives into Disney's Dark Era by Madeline Mason for 14 East Magazine. And finally, Mark Harrison wrote a piece for Den of Geek called The Sherlockian Brilliance of The Great Mouse Detective. And honestly, that one might have been the best. I really enjoyed that one. A lot of good stuff.
A lot of great titles. Very, very good titles, really solid titles.
Yeah.
I had a few sources as well. I read an article on Collider called How the Black Cauldron Nearly Killed Disney Animation, an article on MovieWeb, How the Great Mouse Detective Saved Disney Feature Animation by Victor Garrett, and watched one of my favorite documentaries, which is Waking Sleeping Beauty.
Truly
always
a
good one. We love getting to watch that one.
And if you're looking for more shenanigans like these, make sure to subscribe to the Scenario D podcast wherever you love to listen. And better yet, why not rate us? 5 stars means more people find us, means more people listen to us, means more people are giving us virtual high fives. So please remember that those stars go a long way.
We are also super excited to be bringing you all the facts, feels, and shenanigans over on YouTube. You can now support us by liking, subscribing, ringing the notification bell, and doing everything else you'd normally do for a channel you love. So go watch our latest episode using the link in this episode's description.
And as always, don't forget to catch us on Instagram @ScenarioD Podcast. Why? Because you're going to love the magic we're making there.